Unlike rolling operations, where we create very long strips of sheets, we create very long continuous plates, right? But in forging, you can see individual parts created. So in forging, we produce discontinuous products which are not continuous, and individual parts are created like this, as shown in the in this picture as well. So this is one of the example of very large amount of like a very large product size type of forging, and the process, and these parts are called discrete parts. Okay, so every separate part is called discrete part. Okay, previously in rolling operation, continuous parts were produced. In forging, discrete parts are produced. So here is an example of. If you guys can see, this is looking like a connecting rod of your engine. So forging can be used to create very intricate shapes as well. However, we need to remove this flash. If you can see the outer area, we've got flash or excess material which has come out during the forging operation. During the compression, the material from the sideways came out from the die. So when it came out from the die, then that excess material is called flash. That is something that I need to grind later on and remove it. So these are the final products after we do the forging operation. Okay. So this is an example of a connecting rod. Then there are different types of tools also that we can create. Can create spanners. Okay, we can create variable spanners. So something like this can be created. And you can see this is a die for my forging operation, in which I'm going to put my material, and then I'm going to put the forging hammer, and I will hammer my material inside this die so that my final shape looks like something like this. So it can be used to create tools as well. Here is another example of hot forged steel. And this is basically a flange. These are used in piping operations in industries, okay? In piping industries, in petrochemical industries, and in order to connect two pipes, we need a flange. And this is called a flange for connecting two pipes. And this is this is your rotor hub for your wheel for automobile or mobile application. So this is also, you can see, a very hot part has been and just put inside the large mass of parts. So a lot of parts can be created. So forging is suitable for mass production. 1,000, 2,000, 10,000, 100,000 parts can be produced by a forging machine. So these were some examples of forging process. So as I said, we have got three basic types: open die forging, closed die forging, and precision or flashless forging. Okay, so in open die forging, basically we have got an open die. As I said in the earlier video also, the video in which the person has an open die and he was putting his part in the open die. So this is an example of an open die as well. We've got upper die and a lower die, and in the middle we've got a workpiece, and then we are going to hammer the upper part. The lower part is fixed. So in open die forging, the work is compressed between two flat dies. Compressed metal is allowed to flow without constraint in the lateral direction. So what is basically lateral direction, and what is the meaning of this? Compressed metal is allowed to flow without constraint in the lateral direction. So let's see that in this. So basically, you guys should know that, let's say I've got this part, okay? So the longer dimension or the longest dimension is called longitudinal section or longitudinal direction. So this dimension or this length, the largest dimension is longitudinal. And the smaller dimension is lateral. Okay. So what this guy is saying is that compressed material is allowed to flow without constraint in the lateral direction. It means that in the direction of lateral, means this is my lateral direction and this is my lateral direction. So when I'm going to press my die, okay, the material, my workpiece can move freely in the lateral direction. So I'm compressing my die and my workpiece can move freely in the lateral direction. So move freely means without constraint, means if I put a constraint on something, it means I'm stopping something. Okay. So if I'm basically giving it free, means that it can move freely in the direction. So lateral direction is what the material or piece flows in the lateral direction. The simplest process is open die forging is compression of a cylindrical work part. So as you saw in the video as well, a very simple piece I can put and I can just start doing open die forging process on it. This process is also called upsetting or upset forging process. So remember, open die forging is the simplest type of forging process. So open die is the simplest process. So here is a sequence of operations for open die forging process. Here you can see we have got our die. Okay, this is also called hammer. This hammer is fixed. My workpiece is in the middle. Okay, so when I'm putting the force and hammering my material, then what happens is I can hammer also and I can slowly squeeze also. Okay, so there are two types. One in which the impact is created, I will hammer something. And the other is I will slowly, slowly squeeze the material, okay? So there are two types of forging. So let's say in this one, I'm squeezing my material. So the ideal condition states that when I'm going to squeeze my material, the bulging will not happen, okay? This here you can see we are, this part is bulging, okay? So when I'm going to basically do my forging process, in actual condition, because friction is involved, bulging happen, and this bulging is called barreling effect. Okay, so this bulging is called barreling effect. And as you can see, the more I put the force, the more barrel is produced. This is barreling effect. Why? Because the material in this area is stopped by the friction in this between the die and the workpiece. So because of the friction, the material cannot flow in the square pattern. Okay, in ideal condition, if there is no friction, then what happens is that I will get a square once again, or a rectangular shape, means a perfect rectangular or perfect square. However, when I'm going to press it, what happens is that the material is pulled back due to the friction of the die. So this thing is called barreling, and barreling can develop in upsetting hot workpiece between cold die. The material which is at or near the die surface cools rapidly, and while the rest of the workpiece remains relatively hot. Consequently, the material at the top and bottom of the workpiece has higher resistance to deformation than the material at the center. So another problem is that this part becomes cooler because it is in touch with the die. So when it is in touch with the die, it becomes cooler. When the material is cooler, it is less plastic. When the material is less plastic, it will less deform. So you can see this area is less deform and this area is less deform because the amount of heat here is higher than the amount of heat here. So the material is more soft in the middle, but less softer at the upper part. So two factors are there for barreling. Number one, friction, and number two is the softening of the hardening of the material near the die because the temperature is less, because the temperature is conducted in the die. The temperature conducts from the workpiece towards the die, so the material is more cooler here. So barreling from thermal effects can be reduced by using a heated die. So in order to reduce the heat, this barreling, I can, what I can do is I can heat my die also. Okay, Or if I want to reduce friction, then I can put a lubricant, oil, or a special kind of lubricant to reduce the barreling effect. So, yeah, let's write some important parameters. Okay. So basically, when we are doing the forging process, we are producing strain, right? So in order to basically calculate strain, the strain is usually in the both direction, longitudinal direction also and lateral direction also. However, for forging process, because the area, cross-sectional area is this one, okay, that is why we account for the strain in the longitudinal direction. So true strain is experienced by the work under ideal condition, which is given by epsilon H naught over H, where H is the starting height, this is the starting height of the work in millimeters, and H is the intermediate height at one point during the process. So whenever I apply a force, then the height at which the force was applied is this current height. Then the force required to continue the compression is given by force is equals to YF into area, where YF is the flow stress corresponding to the true strain and is given by YF is equals to K epsilon N. So let us write these formulas so that we can understand them better. Okay. So we have true strain. So formula number one, true strain. Suppose this is my workpiece and this is my die. Before applying force, my height is H naught, and after applying force, my height reduced to a certain number, let's say H. Okay. So the true strain is given by epsilon. Epsilon is equals to LN. Okay, I will LN H naught over H, where H naught is the initial height. And H is the current height. So true strain is given by the logarithmic function ln H naught over H. And the unit of both of these height can be in millimeters. So usually we are interested in how much force should I apply to reduce the height. So we need to find the force as well. So the force required this is number two. Force required F is equals to YF into area. Okay. YF into area. Which area? Okay. So basically, because we are applying force on this die, due to this force, a reaction force is created. So basically, we are interested in the force. The direction of force is this, so the perpendicular area is this one. Okay, direction of force is downward, so the perpendicular area is this one, right? So if I'm going to draw, let's say, my force, then this is my force. And in three dimension, if I'm going to look in three dimension, okay, this is my workpiece. So my area would be the cross-sectional, three-dimensional cross-sectional area, this one. In case of a cylinder, it will be cylindrical. Okay, so this is the cross-sectional area. So A is the cross-sectional area and YF YF is equals to the flow stress. Usually given in megapascals. Megapascal means Newton per millimeter square. And how to calculate YF? YF is equals to K epsilon to the power n, where K is the strength coefficient. In the previous class also, K was the strength coefficient. The strength coefficient will be given to you guys, okay? And strain hardening component or exponent will be given to you as well. Strain hardening exponent is denoted by small n, strain hardening exponent, which is different for different materials. I can give you a table also, because in the table in the previous lecture we saw a table in which the strain hardening exponent was given for different copper, aluminium, steel, and the what you call strength coefficient was also given. So force required formula, then you got YF formula as well. So this is formula number 3, this is formula number 2. Now let's move to the next slide. So in open die forging, okay, as you can see, in actual condition there is friction also between the work and the die surface. We saw in rolling process also there was friction involved, so we need to accommodate friction also in our force formula, okay? So actually upsetting force is higher than the ideal force. So if there is friction, then friction is resisting force. It means I need to resist and I need to overcome friction also, and then overcome material also. So it means that my actual force that I want to apply is very high because I have to resist friction also. So that is why we need to introduce a friction factor as well. So the actual force required in upsetting process, actual force is F is equals to KF. This is another thing, KF. Okay. YF is the flow stress multiplied by the cross-sectional area. Okay. Where KF is forging factor, forging shape factor. And to calculate or to get the value of kf, we need to refer to table. Refer table 14.2 in the book. Okay. Also, to calculate KF, we have another formula. KF is equals to 1 plus 0.4 friction coefficient into D whole divided by H, where D is the workpiece diameter. D is workpiece diameter. So we can calculate K manually also, and we can calculate K from the table as well if it is given.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes,
so
yes.
For the diameter of the workpiece, is it use the initial one or final one?
So the diameter of the workpiece which we are going to use is the instant one at that time. So they will so this D, if you can see this D here, okay, and you can see in the diagram also we've got a D, right? So this D is the diameter at a certain, after a certain operation. Okay, so the height is, let's say the initial height is 30, then after I apply 100,000 kilonewton force, the height is reduced to let's say 28. So the value of my H is 28. Then initially my diameter was 50. Then after I do the forging operation, the diameter increased to 55, right? So my current instant diameter during the operation or after the operation, that diameter we are going to put in our value of KF. Usually, sometimes in the table, a table is also given, okay, range of K values for different types of shapes, okay. So if I have a very simple shape without any flashing which is going to occur, then the K is in the range of 3 to 5. So these are simple range values also given, but hopefully I think you guys will calculate using formulas perhaps.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So these were some of the formulas which will be involved in our forging operation or forging process. So I will hide this. So in open die forging, very simple shapes can be created, such as circular tubes, okay, even some different types of rods, etc. So it is a process that is used for creating very simple shapes such as shafts, rings, disc, etc. Open die forging produces a very rough shape. If you can see, the shape is quite rough. The surface finish, if you can see, we have got quite rough surface here as well. So the surface is also not very good. So after this open die forging operation, I need to maybe grind the surface or polish the surface as well. So a second operation needs to be done. That is why this forging, open die forging, is not a near net shape process, because the final product cannot be used in the market immediately. I cannot sell this product in the market. First, I need to clean it, I need to do other operations, and then only I can do it. So open die forging is just for doing rough work or the previous work for additional operation. Open die forging creates a favorable grain flow and good metallurgical structure in the material. Now, open die forging have additional types, okay, very basic types. Type number one is fullering, number two is edging, and number three is cogging. So in fullering process, if you can see here, in the fullering process, open die forging fullering process, the die is made of convex surface. So the surface of this die is convex. Okay. So what is going to happen? My area will reduce in the same manner. Okay. So here you can see, as an example, the area is reduced from the middle. So to reduce the cross-sectional area, what we do is we use open die forging fullering process. Next is open die forging edging process. So in this edging process, you can see the shape of this die is concave. So when the shape of this die is concave, my shape of my part will also be concave. Okay. Oh, sorry, it will be convex. Okay. So concave is going to produce a convex part. And then there is another operation called cogging operation. In cogging operation, basically, cogging consists of a sequence of forging compressions. So what I'm going to do is basically I'm going to apply force here, reduce the area, then the material will move forward. Then I will do again an operation of forging, then the material will move forward. So initially the thickness was high, and then I will continuously hammer my material. So basically cogging operation is like I've got these two dies, and this is my material. So I will keep on reducing the thickness of my part, but the length will increase by what you call sequence of forging operation. So these are sequences. So cogging is used in steel industries to produce bloom and slabs from ingots, and it is accomplished by using open dies. So the dies is open. So, but you can see that the shape is a little bit contour at the corner. Okay, that is very important. It basically helps in the removal of stress concentration at the corner. If my corners are very sharp, there will be stress concentration and the corners can break off. So that is why I produce contour surface on the corner. You can see the corner is contour. Okay, so here's a video of an example of cogging operation being carried out in heavy industries. This is normal open die forging, okay, process. A very hot piece is put in between two, in between the hammer, and now this is impact forging, okay. And you can see this barreling occurring also. Here you can see the shape has become barrel from the corner, okay. So a series of compressive impact or hammering can produce different types of products. Now this is a cogging operation, okay, in which I am basically slowly I'm going to move forward my piece and reduce the thickness. Sorry, not this one actually. This is I think simple forging. There is one in which they did the cogging also. I want to show you guys the cogging one. Yeah, this one. So slowly increasing the thickness. Sorry, decreasing the thickness, increasing the length. So this length has increased. You can see how long it has become now already. This is bloom that they created. And there is another one in which they created the flange of a product. If you can see, just a second. Yeah. So in this one is basically impression forging, a closed die. I've got a closed die also on the corner. So I'm not allowing the material to basically come out from the corners, okay? So basically a flange or a circular product was also created. It requires a lot of manpower to do this, these kinds of operations. And last but not least, this is another type of cogging operation. Reducing the thickness. Here thickness is higher, here the cross-sectional area is lesser or smaller. So these are some of the examples of different forging operations. So just now we saw this open die forging process. We can do it in various ways. We can have a vertically aligned die, and then we can have we can basically align the material then horizontally to the die as well. So there are various ways by which we can basically shape our material. So this was all about open die forging, in which we've got fullering, etching, and cogging operations. Now let's move to closed die forging. In the video, in the example, you saw that from the sideways also the material was closed. So closed die forging is also called impression die forging, and it is performed with dies that have inverse of the desired shape. As the die closes, the flash is formed by excess metal. Now this flash is very, very important actually. It is desirable also that I have some flash coming out. Flash is something, although we remove it, but it has an important function. Flash cools more rapidly than the rest of the metal, and the already cool flash prevents more flash from coming and the force the metal to completely fill the die cavity. So here I've got a die, and the shape of the die is not flat now. Now the shape of the die has an impression, okay? It has the shape that I want to get in the final product. So my final shape should be like this. That is why my die is shaped. So that is why it is called impression die forging. So the starking workpiece is put as a raw material, and then once we put inside, we apply continuous forging hammers, okay? And then what we get is my final product with some flashes. These flashes are good and important also, that we can later on remove the flash, but it helps this material flash from not developing also. After the flash is developed, it cools down, because this flash is more near to the die. So since it is more near to the die, it cools more faster and more rapidly. After that, what happens is that the flash prevents more flash from occurring. Okay, so it is in one way desirable also. So here is an example of a connecting rod, okay, forced connecting rod. And after preparation of the connecting rod, we can do further machining to get the final connecting rod. So closed die forging is not capable of closed tolerance work because further machining is often required to achieve desired accuracy. The basic geometry is obtained by the forging process, and then machining is performed to create the precision finishing such as holes and threads. So why forge then machine? Why not machine the whole part completely? Because in forging you can see that you can rapidly hammer the material and immediately we can get my workpiece. Whereas in casting it takes a lot of time. It is very time consuming, but forging is very rapid. So that is why we do and prefer forging operation than casting or machining, because forging is very rapid and it has very high production rate. The strength is also very high. When I'm hammering the material, when I'm going to hammer my material, it is called tempering process. And tempering is basically a type of heat treatment process in which we hammer a material to basically increase the strength. As we hammer the material, the grains basically elongate on the surface. And as the grains elongate, what happens is that they elongate in a certain direction and they become smaller as well. So the strength increases in this manner. And favorable grain orientation is also obtained on the surface. So just now we looked into closed die forging. Let's have a look at flashless forging or precision forging. In the previous closed forging process, flashes came out, right? But in this process, the flash is not going to occur because my die, if you can see, this die is completely closed, okay? So what happens is that at the end of the day, the workpiece is completely contained in the cavity of my die. So it is similar to impression, but it is more demanding because we need to continuously do the forging process repeatedly. We need to do the forging process and create my workpiece. Flash is not produced. However, the work volume must be equal to the space. So this work volume should be exactly equal to the space that is provided for my finished part. That is why it is called precision forging, because the work volume should be precisely exactly equal to the die cavity. If it is too large, then excessive pressure can damage the die. So if my workpiece is very large, then what is going to happen is that more pressure will be created and it will damage my die or punch. And if it is too small, the cavity is not filled. So flashless forging is suitable for simple symmetrical parts, and it is usable for materials such as aluminum and magnesium. Last but not the least, we have forging operation called coining operation. So you guys must have seen different coins, right? Those coins are basically made from forging operation also. Basically, an impression is created on my die. So my die has an impression of coin, and then I'm going to forge my impression on my coin to create a shape. So if you can see, let's say this is my coin shape, okay? And then coin shape, we can create medals, we can create jewelries, etc. So in order to put, you can put logos also. So in order to put there is an impression on my die. So coining is basically a special application of closed die forging. Fine details in the die are impressed into the top and bottom surface. So the details of my coins or my medal is impressed in the upper and lower part. So this is mostly used for coining, producing coins. So this was all about the the theory of forging. Let's do a simple numerical. Okay. So a cylindrical part is, so it is cylindrical. Okay. First thing is first. We need to do what is given data. So before starting numerical, what is the given data? A cylindrical part is to be forged. So my part is cylindrical. Okay, the initial diameter is 45 millimeter. Okay, so the initial diameter is 45 millimeter. Okay. And the initial height is 40 millimeters. So D naught is given, H naught is equals to 40 millimeter. The height after forging is 25 millimeter. So H is equals to 25 millimeters. The coefficient of friction at the die work interface is 0.20. So friction coefficient is, I will show it here. Just a second, let me write it down. So coefficient of friction is 0.20. The yield strength of our work material is 285 megapascal. So the yield strength is 285 megapascal, and its flow curve is defined by strength coefficient K. K is equals to 600 megapascal. Strain hardening exponent. Strain hardening exponent N is equals to 0.12. Determine the force in the operation. Determine the force in the operation. Just as the yield point reaches yield at strain E equals to 0.002. So just at yield means the strain given is 0.002. And B is at the height of mm. So I've got my cylinder. Okay. Let's say this is cylinder and I am applying my force. Okay, so let me put it here because you guys can copy it given data. Okay. So since initially my height was 40 mm, after applying the force, it is 25 mm. But now it is saying in the question that if my strain, so I apply a force until material's yield strength, and if my strain is 0.002, then what is this value of force? Okay, so initially the height is 40 mm, finally it is 25 mm, but during the operation what happened is that my material reaches yield strength, okay, at a strain of 0.002. So at this point, what should be the force? Okay, this is the question. So actually it has still not reached 25 mm, because we are just about to reach the yield strength. So to overcome this yield strength, what's the force that I need to apply? So this is the question. Okay, so the formulas are given. Okay, so this is given data. So this is number one is given data. Okay, so number two is applied formulas. So what we need to do is we need to find the force. So what is the formula for force? Force is equals to Kf, this is the forging shape factor, Kf, multiplied by Yf is the flow stress, multiplied by the cross-sectional area. Okay. Now, do we know Kf? We don't know Kf. It means we need to either refer to a table or we need to basically create a use the formula. Okay. Then we don't know Yf also. Yf is also not given. And we also don't know the area also. So these three things are not given. So we need to put the formula for these three things also. So what is the formula for Kf now? Kf is equals to 1 plus 0.4 friction coefficient into T whole divided by H. Okay. One plus 0.4 into diameter is 45. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And YF formula, YF is equals to K epsilon N. Okay. And what is the formula for area? Area is equals to volume divided by the current height. Height is current. Height when the strain is 0.002. So when the strain is 0.002, what is my height? I want to find the force when the strain is 0.002. That is why I want to get the I want to get the height when the strain is 0.002. Why the area? Which area we are going to use? Basically, this is my area, my cylinder, and this cylinder has a volume, has a diameter D is equals to 45 mm. Okay, so how to calculate the volume, initial volume? And this is my cylinder. The height of the cylinder is given, H is equals to 40 mm. And diameter is given. So the volume is equals to pi r square l. Okay. So even during the forging process, the volume will remain same, but the area will change because the diameter will change. The height will change, the diameter will change, but the volume of the material will remain same. So let us first calculate the volume of my material also. And also one more thing, another formula is strain. Strain is equals to ln H naught over H. Okay, so these are the given formulas that we are going to apply for solving this numerical. So let's go to solution part 3. So to calculate force, I need Kf, I need Yf, I need area. To calculate Kf, I need 1 plus 0.4 mu d over h. Okay, this one I know the values already. To calculate Yf, I have k into epsilon n. So I need to, I already know the value of strain also, I know the value of K also. And to calculate area, I need volume and height. Okay, so I need to calculate two things for my area. So let's go to solution. For cross-sectional area, I need volume also and I need height also, these two things. So how to calculate volume? Very simple. So V is equals to pi r square L. Okay, so the value is V is equals to pi into so diameter is 45, so radius is 22.5, so 22.5 whole square multiplied by the initial height is 40. So the volume comes out to be 63.6317 millimeter cube. This is my volume, initial volume. So the question is now how to calculate the height. Okay, so we know that strain is equals to ln h over h naught, right? So we know the initial height h naught, which is 40 mm over h, and the value of epsilon or strain is given as 0.20. 0.20 is equals to ln 40 over h. So what it is written, I don't know this log operation, but h is equals to 40 minus 40 into 0.002. So my height comes out to be 39.92 millimeter. So this height is when the strain is 0.002. At this point, at this location, my height is 39.92. Sorry, 92. So I want to calculate now area when my strain is 0.002. So area when the strain is 0.002 is equals to volume, which remains constant, divided by the height at the rate 0.002. Okay, so the area comes out to be 63617 divided by 39.92. This comes out to be 1594 millimeter square. So this is my area when my strain is 0.002. Because I want to calculate force when strain is equals to 0.002. So let's go back and see what else we need to calculate. So to calculate the force, we need area. Now area is done. Now we calculate YF. Okay. So what was the formula for YF? YF is equals to K epsilon N. Okay. So YF is equals to K epsilon N. So YF is equals to K was given as 600. Strength coefficient is 600 megapascal and strain hardening component is 0.12. So strength coefficient is 600 multiplied by strain is 0.002 to the power 0.12. So my YF comes out to be 284.6 megapascal. So now I know my YF, now I know my area. So what is left now? So now I need to calculate KF. The formula for KF is 1 plus 0.4 mu D over H. And I think there is a mistake in the formula. So the student who just asked me the question previously, that for the formula for K, what should we do? Which value diameter should we use? Okay. So that student was, his concerns were correct actually. So this formula was written in the slides incorrectly. I think. Just a second. So the student was correct actually, this guy. So KF is 0.04 mu D over H, okay? So this is basically now in the solution, it is showing initial diameter and initial height. So if it is initial diameter and initial height, then what should happen is that we should have D naught here and we should have H naught here. So this is the forcing shape factor. So the formula was incorrect. Thank you for highlighting this to me. So because in the solution they have used the initial values. So I will go back. I will correct my mistake now. Okay. So I will go back to the formulas. And I'm going to put D naught and H naught here. So now this is the correct formula. So now it is D naught and H naught. So let's start, resume our calculation. So KF is equals to 1 plus 0.4 mu D naught over H naught. So KF is equals to 1 plus 0.4 multiplied by my friction was 0.20. My height was, sorry, diameter was 45. Whole divided by my H naught is 40. Oh, another mistake. Sorry guys, there is a lot of confusion actually. Sorry guys. So there is another mistake actually in the solution also. So in the solution, it is something else written. I will show you the solution later on. So this is, so the final formula now for K is not, this H is not H naught. Sorry for this. So D is H naught. Only D is H naught and this is not H naught. Okay. This is the current height, the value. So it's quite confusing actually. This thing is confusing. So the D which we are going to take is H naught. D is D naught. And H is going to be the height at that moment. So there is a confusion. Yeah. Sorry for that. So if I will rewrite again the formula in my solution so that there is no confusion, I go back and I'm going to remove H naught as H. Okay, so this is H in my formula, and this formula also is H, current height. H, which H at the rate when strain is equals to 0.002. Yeah, it's a bit confusing that in KF formula you are using initial height. You're using initial diameter, but you're not using the height, initial height. I don't know why is that, but it looks like it is the formula. So there is not much we can do. So the height which I calculated in the previous one was 39.92, this one. So I go back and put 39.92. So KF comes out to be 1.09, because in the book this formula is not given, it's only given in the slides. So this is the answer for KF. It has no units. So my force now is equals to KF into YF into area at the rate 0.002, and this is the force at the rate 0.002. So force comes out to be 1.09 multiplied by 284.6 multiplied by 1594. Okay, so the force comes out to be 494,000 newtons. This is the final answer. Quite confusing, yeah. But anyways, now we know which formula, which how to calculate KF. So this was all about this numerical, and in part B, they are saying, if the height is if the height is 30, so if the height is 30 mm, okay, then calculate the force. Then what is the force at 30 mm? So I think this part you guys can calculate later on also. So the solution for it is given. Final answer is given is 1,247,536 Newton. 1,247,536 Newtons. So this is the answer. So if you have a confusion in this numerical, let me know. I will repeat once again. I will repeat the numerical. I will repeat the steps if you guys want. If not, then we will proceed. Okay, so we will proceed to our last slide. Okay, so there is solution. This one is the last slide of our lecture today. Economics of forging. So as you guys know that to create a part, to create a single product or to create a single part, it requires some cost, okay? And the process of planning our equipment, our tools, and the cost of the product, and what is the break-even point that we are going to achieve is called economics of a manufacturing operation. So this is a chart. In this chart, on the x-axis, we have got the number of pieces, the number of forging pieces that I will produce. And in the y-axis, I have the number amount of price that is increasing. Okay. So increasing number of pieces increases price per pieces. So as you can see, that if I'm going to create a lot of pieces, let's say I'm going to create 1,000 pieces, then what happens is that if I'm going to cut it on the curve, then my cost is, let's say, $10. Okay. And if I'm going to create only 10 pieces, okay, then if I intersect it upwards, then my cost is $1,000. So for 1,000 pieces, my cost is $10. It means that the more number of pieces I create, the more I can sell it. The more I can sell it, the more profit I can make, right? That is why I can reduce the price of my product if I create a lot of number of pieces. And if my number of pieces are, let's say, only 10 only, then it is like custom making. So you know that custom car builds, custom making something is very expensive. So, you know, custom Vira cost around $40,000, sorry, 40,000 ringgit. But if you just buy a normal part and do the repair or normal operation repair, then it will cost 5,000 perhaps. So 10 parts will cost $1,000. So this is the relationship of number of pieces with the cost of piece. So depending on the complexity of forging process, the cost of tool and die range from moderate to high. So they are saying is that the tooling cost so if this is the tool cost, if you can see this light green part is tool cost. And this is the dark green part. This dark green part is the setup cost. And then below this dark green is a little bit darker green. This part is material cost. Okay. So the material cost is almost same. Okay. Because the material cost will remain fixed. The only cost which is varying is the tool cost. Okay. Tool cost and setup cost. So what happens is that as I do this manufacturing of number of parts increases, the setup time and the setup cost decreases also, because I already have set up my material, and then the more number of pieces I create, the more lesser the setup cost is spread. Okay. Similarly, the more I create the number of pieces, the total tooling cost also reduces because I am selling more number of pieces. So the ratio of the cost of die material to the total cost of forging increases with the weight of forging but decreases with the number of parts. So if my weight of forging, let's say I want to create 10 kg of parts, then if the weight increases from 10 kg to 100 kg, then forging cost also increases. But if the number of parts increases, then the forging cost decreases. These are the economics of forging. The more expensive the material, the higher the cost of material relative to the total cost. The size of forging also has an effect on the cost. So if I am creating a large product, then the cost will be a bit higher. So these were in general the economics of forging.